Actually, you guys, I know I missed the class interaction because I mean I can't see you guys, right? Most of you are most of you turned off the videos. I can't see your facial expressions, which I rely heavily when I'm teaching, because you don't have to say anything. If I look at your face, especially your eyes, I can tell when someone is stuck and I need to go over again. But because everyone is kind of in the hey, Jason. It's hard for me, like unless I scroll to see the rest of you. Like Jason was talking and I was like, who's talking? Because I couldn't see Jason's face. I'll be very honest. You guys have just taken your quiz one for this class, right? And I've been saying this because I've taught online before. I've taught asynchronous. I've taught video streaming live all at the same time before I came to TNCC. This is how my class was set up at ODU. And I've been saying students tend to do, in general, students tend to do much better in a live environment rather than in an asynchronous or video streaming or online environment. And even in this course, because I got two sections, I got you guys and I have Jaehyun's asynchronous course. And looking at the grades on the first quiz, the live sections is so much better than the asynchronous. And like Bobby said, if it's asynchronous, students are kind of on their own and you have to have the self-discipline to do the work. And this is why I am so torn. I know asynchronous, it's beneficial to some students who have full-time jobs and who can come to, I guess, on campus or to take live classes. But at the same time, I know they're gonna fall behind on their own. That's why I want to kind of get your feedback. I'm kind of leaning towards synchronous for your mechanics of materials, because you guys, I'll be offering dynamics and mechanics of materials. And I'm thinking of making mechanics live and dynamics as asynchronous to kind of provide an alternative to students who cannot make it to a live session. So if a student, you know, likes the live class, then he or she can take the mechanics of materials in spring and take dynamics in the fall or something like that. And then I will alternate because I
Another thing I know is for me, like I use the GI Bill, and in order to get paid for the semester, I have to have synchronous classes.
Oh, really? They will not pay for asynchronous? I did not know that, Bobby.
They don't because like if you we with the GI Bill we get a housing allowance, and you have to be like it's based off of how many credits you take and like what classes you take, and in order to get the actual housing allowance, you actually have to go to campus,
Oh,
like
that,
to
I mean, I kind of knew
classes.
of the GI Bill and how it works with the credit hours, but I didn't know
Yeah,
that it has.
we actually have to go to the class, and then because of everything going on, they made it so you had to take a synchronous class where you
Synchronous
actually had to sit down
class.
and be present in order to
I
get
see. I
that
see.
during this time.
Okay, so if I make mechanics of materials live synchronous, then you can take that one. But you're saying that you won't be able to take dynamics and get credit for that one or get
No,
the allowance
I
for
get
that.
credit. I just have to have at least one synchronous class in order to
Oh.
get the like you have to go to the campus, and the synchronous classes are counting as going to campus since we can't go to
Okay.
campus.
Yeah, but that's only for the rest of this year. They're talking about trying to extend it, but that's up in the air right now.
Yeah, but like if TNCC and other schools aren't doing it, they have to do it. Like
Yeah,
there's no other
because I can
option,
tell
so.
you right now, it's looking more, we've been told to schedule spring semester just like the fall, as if we're going to be online and with very limited classes on campus, especially for those classes that require lab, they have to be on campus. But if not, they're encouraging us to stay at home and teach from our home, I guess, right? So now we're down to, so if we're teaching from home, do we want to make our classes synchronous? And I can tell you most faculty, most of them are going asynchronous. And I think I was kind of trying it out with you guys. You guys are the only live synchronous class I have this semester. And personally, I enjoy this a whole lot more than asynchronous. Speaking to just a camera and recording myself is not fun.
No.
And through our, what happened, Jan?
No, I was agreeing with you. Just speaking to a camera, you just get no interaction.
Exactly. Yeah. So, you know, the interaction and with your questions, and I'm sure that's what Jayon is coming to the live class because you get more questions that are being asked that you may not even have thought about, right? So you get more benefit out of the class interaction.
Yes.
And I actually enjoy this, even though I'm seeing like the right now a complete black screen with your names just dotted across. I don't see anybody right now. I know some of you guys have the cameras on and most of you don't, which is fine because I feel the same way most of the time. But this to me gives me more sanity. Okay, so I know only a few of you have spoken, but I think I will make at least one of my classes, Mechanics of Materials Live, which is a continuation of statics. And then maybe I will make dynamics asynchronous for students who cannot make it to class. And then I guess maybe in the fall of 2021, we'll be back in the classrooms and everything will go live again. Okay, well, thank you for. For me, I know hybrid is an option, but I'm not very fond of hybrid. And the reason is because that means one class it has to be live and one class has to be asynchronous. So if you have a full-time job or if you have a job around the time the class is offered, even hybrid is not going to help. But I do have office hours, and I know it does. Most of you don't come to my office hours, but every week when I have a test due or a quiz due, it's like having a class. I have a whole bunch of my students, and we use the office hour time virtually to go over. And they share their screens with me, and I just mark it off or correct their mistakes right there and then with them. So it's like a class, but more of discussion and more interaction than me just lecturing, if that makes sense. So I'm not very a big fan of hybrid model. But that's what the asynchronous, but that's what the asynchronous class is getting right now. Like Jayon is getting all the recordings of the homework problems that we go over in this class and the examples that I do with you guys in class. The only recording that they don't get are the notes, right? When I go over the class notes with you guys, that's not that my asynchronous class is not getting that because they're on their own to read the notes and read the textbook sections being covered. So they're kind of on their own when it comes to the notes, but the examples and the problems, I actually make recordings. That's why I said that's my backup in case something goes wrong in our live session. At least I have the recordings to kind of fall back on and for me to you guys. Okay, because my schedule is due and they're really asking for us to determine whether your classes should be synchronous or asynchronous. And, you know, well, that's my problem. It's not your problem, but that's what I have to decide. But thank you for your feedback. That does really help a lot for me to make a decision. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna share. Oh, let me take attendance. I was taking attendance before. Let me quickly look at your name so that I don't hold you guys back. Okay, I got Jaehyun here. Ty. Okay, it's Jason. I got you on the first page. Louis, I got Khaled is here. Okay, Bailey is here. Logan. So if I offer live, will most of you make it next semester?
Most likely.
Yeah.
Okay, good. I know it's not exactly a live classroom experience, but this is better than just the recording. At least for me, more fun.
It's Michael, by the way. What class is that that you're talking about? Because I don't think I have to take another engineering class unless it's an elective.
It depends on your major. What's your major again, Michael?
Associates in Science. I forget what exactly it is, but it's a transfer for
Wait, what is it again?
Associates in Science to transfer for chemical engineering.
Hey, oh, so you're going for mechanical engineering. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, for chemical engineering.
Oh, chemical engineering, chemical engineering. No, you do not have to take my classes anymore.
Okay. Aw.
Yeah. So it will be your chemistry. You will have to take organic chemistry one and two,
Right.
right? And labs.
Okay.
And I think most of them are offer, even during regular semesters, I think they offer organic maybe as a virtual online. I've seen that before. So I don't know if they're still going to be doing that. So I'm missing Christopher again, or maybe he'll walk in later. And Jake is still not here. Okay, so Michael, no, you don't have to, it doesn't apply to you because you'll be taking chemistry classes and you're done with pretty much engineering classes. Okay, so what I want to do is I want to share with you the quiz, because I said I will go over this with you guys. And I think I really need to go over this. Let me get your, okay, I need to move you guys over to my left side so I can see the screen. Okay, so I'm gonna skip over the easy ones, right? You got most of the fill in the blank, the resultant. And again, if you guys use a capital letter R, I change and I give you back the 3 points that Canvas deducted. Statics, right? It's the rigid bodies. Again, there's no deformation in this class. And of course, I said this to before, in real life, in reality, everything goes through deformation and changes, right? But these changes are so small that they're considered to be negligible in what we have to do in this class. But when you are in mechanics of materials in the future, these are the calculations that we'll carry out, the small changes in the length or the shape or the deformations in general. So that's coming. So let's take a look at this one here. Why does it say Q sub X? How come it changed? It's supposed to be theta sub X here. What is the angle of inclination for the following force? That angle 30 there, is that the angle of inclination for this force?
No.
It's not. Of course not, right? So it's a complementary angle to the angle of inclination of this force. So all you had to tell me was that it was 60 degrees, but you had to use the correct significant figures. Now for this problem, I did not take a point off if you just left it at 60, but it really should have been 60.0 degrees, okay? So that one wasn't so bad. This one surprised me a lot. Many of you did not get this one correctly done. So before we do anything, is there an angle of inclination for this force?
Yes.
Is that Lewis?
It's Robert, Bobby.
I'm sorry, Bobby. Sorry. Okay, so how do you determine the so-called angle of inclination or the amount of inclination given that you have a right triangle with sides 6 and 8?
Toa. You use tangent?
Okay, you can use a tangent and you can use tangent to find the angle of inclination, or you use 6, 8, 10, right? Let me see. Can I annotate? Let me see if I can annotate here.
Use the golden rule.
Sure. And that will give you what?
200 for the X, 150 for the Y.
Sure. So, and for future problems, and I've done this with you guys in class. So you got 6 squared. Plus 8 squared, giving you 10 squared, right? So the hypotenuse of this is 10. Oh, that's bad writing. Or you could have done tangent of theta sub x, because right here is your theta, right? Opposite over adjacent, oops, 8. And that should give you the angle of inclination. But my preferred way is this. And I know, Lewis, you told me the answer here already, but F sub X should come out to be the magnitude times 8 over 10, which is 200 newtons. But what's wrong with my final answer here?
It's my only F sub one significant X. Digit.
Exactly. So I need to have 3. And don't make this mistake on your test in case something like this shows up. It should be 200 decimal point to make it into a 3 significant answer. Okay, so F sub Y, again, the magnitude times 6 over 10, giving you 150 newtons. How many sig figs should I be using here?
4.
Very good. So you have to have 150.0 newtons. Okay. Now I did not require any work because I realized if you have the lockdown browser on, I wasn't sure because I've never used it as a student. So I don't know how it shows on your screen. I was afraid that you won't be able to upload any file. That's why I did not ask for any work. But I gave you enough space in your answer box in case you wanted to show any work, but it was not necessary. So this one should not have taken you too long to do, right? You just had to use 6, 8, and 10, and then find the X and the Y component. Okay, let me clear. How do I clear? Okay, there is the clear button. Okay, so let's go down. Next one. This one, okay. So if the given mass of a particle is 175 kilogram, what is its corresponding force? Now I got a couple of students saying, why do I need to solve for a force when the particle is not in motion? Well, if you're sitting or moving, there is still a force exerted on your body. And what do we call that force?
Gravity.
Gravity, very good. So if the given mass is 175 kilogram, the force that I'm referring to is its weight due to the force of gravity. So you do not need to be in motion to be feeling this gravity, right? You're feeling it at all times. So how do you find the weight? And we went over this in your chapter one. W is equal to mg, where m is your mass and g is your gravity. And m in this case is 175 kilogram. And what gravitational constant should I use here?
9.81 meters second squared.
Very good, 9.81 meters per second squared. And you have to use 9.81, not 9.8 meters per second squared. If you use this, I will mark you wrong. And the reason is because we're using three significant figures. Everything has to be either in three or four. Okay, so please use this, and this is from your textbook. And what do we get after this? We get using four significant figures, 17 newtons. Okay, so similar to this problem, now I turned it around and I said, what if your force exerted is 700, or the force applied to a particle is 750 newtons, then what is its corresponding mass? What do? You still use the same equation, and this time we're looking for the mass. So you use mass is equal to the weight divided by gravity. And the weight in this case is in newtons, so 750 newtons is equal to kilogram meters per second square divided by our constant of 9.81 meters per second square. Notice that meters per second square are canceled out, and you get in three significant figures, 76.5 kilogram. You have to know this for this class, okay? You have to know this. Any question on these two? This was a pretty common mistake. Okay, let me clear the screen so I can scroll down. Okay, so for the force shown identifies, okay, by the way, when I say characteristic, what are we talking about? We're talking about the magnitude. We're talking about the angle of inclination. We're talking about the sense. We're talking about the point of application, right? And usually I never ask you guys to characterize the point of application, even though it's there, because when you're characterizing a vector, you need to have the magnitude, the angle of inclination, and the sense. So in this problem, 60 degrees, which is highlighted, what do we call this 60 degrees? What characteristic is this?
The angle of inclination.
Very good. It's the angle of inclination. That's it. I did not give you 30 degrees right here. If I gave you this and then I asked you for 30, that is not the angle of inclination. I gave you 60. So that is the angle of inclination. Okay. Need to clear this. Okay. So 500 Newton for this force. What do we call this?
Magnitude.
Magnitude, very good. I've got very strange answers for these characteristics. Some people just repeated what I asked, like giving me 500 newtons. So that was an indication to me that students did not quite understood or remember what it means by characteristic. Okay, even though we've been using this term over and over and over again, it has to stick with you. You have to know this. For this one was interesting. Part C, it's highlighted the letter A. It's not particle. Particle is not a characteristic. A is referring to the point of application of the force. It's not the sense. If I wanted the sense, I would have highlighted the arrowhead. So A is an indication that this is the point of application of the force. Okay. Only a handful of you got that one right. D, I was so glad I went over this before your quiz because most of you got this one right. D, the dotted line is referring to the line of action of the force, okay? Okay, let me see. Oh, everyone got this one right. This one was an easy one, so very good. This one, okay. I think we need to go over this one. Okay, so we have our two force coplanar system. What is the angle? Why is it doing this? Didn't it show up as theta sub x or angle phi on your paper?
I think it did.
I thought it did too, right? Because I checked it, but I don't know why all of a sudden now it's saying f. But it's supposed to be phi, the Greek letter. And I know some of you guys use your Greek letters in your answers too, which was, I was like so impressed. I was very impressed that you guys were able to figure that out. Okay, so the angle of phi, maybe I should put this flat because my handwriting is getting messy. Stop this video. Okay, let me flip this over. So let me draw my parallelogram, sketch it quickly. When you use this, you have R, that is your resultant. An angle that is corresponding to your resultant force is right here, that's your angle phi. Okay, so how do we find this angle phi? You're given 30 and 50 right here, so can you figure this angle out? Let me call this alpha. Sure. Was it Bobby?
Yeah.
Okay, so Bobby, how do we find alpha?
You add those two together and then subtract it from 180.
Very good. Which gives you 100 degrees, but that's not our phi. And how do we find our phi? Notice that alpha plus phi must equal, there are two consecutive angles. That means they must equal to 180, right? So your phi is basically 180 minus your alpha, which gives you 80.0 degrees. Okay. Now, I did not ask you to find the resultant force, but by going in this process, you would be using the parallelogram law to find it, right? Which I didn't ask you to do in this case. Okay, so let's move down to the next. I gotta clear the whole, okay. Okay, this one was good. You guys saw from the, I erased it, but it was in the fourth quadrant. Okay, so this is the last problem, and this is where many of you lost points. You have to be able to handle something like this for your test. You have to understand the resultant forward and backward. This is what I consider to be a forward question because I'm just straightforwardly asking to find the resultant force. So what method should you have used here on your scrap paper? What method should you have used?
Method of components.
Very good. Method of components. I think that was Jaehyun's voice. Okay, so the method of components meaning R sub x, there are five steps involved. Some of the forces in the x equal to zero. So starting again from the first quadrant, 100 pounds times cosine 15, right? Minus 120 pounds times. Now notice that 25 is that is not the angle of inclination of this force. So I have to use sine of 25 because your x component right here is directly opposite to angle 25, which means it's sine of 25. And what else is there? You got finally minus 75 pounds. That is just the horizontally applied force. That's it. So your R sub X should have been minus 29.1216 pounds. Step two, R sub Y. Sum of the force in the Y equal to zero. So again, starting with 100 pounds, sine 15 plus 120 times cosine of 25. Because for 120 pounds, your F sub Y is adjacent to angle 25, and therefore it has to be cosine 25. And of course, 75 pounds does not have any vertical component. So the sum should have been 134.6388 pounds. Step three, your magnitude you square this negative, you get a positive, right? 134.6388 square, that's supposed to be 2. And your R in 4 significant figures should have been 137.8 pounds. Step 4, your angle of inclination, tangent of theta sub X, R sub Y over R sub X, and your angle should have come out to 77.8 degrees. Okay, and then finally, the sense, and I said, because I expected you guys not to upload anything, I said, you can't graph this without taking the time to figure things out in the text box. So I said, just tell me the quadrant in which the resultant force would lie, and that was in quadrant 2, okay? And you could have done this very easily by plotting, right? So if you got X and Y, your X is negative, your Y is positive. So when you construct your rectangle, your R is in the second quadrant, okay? This one was probably the longest question on this quiz, but again, it should not have taken you more than 10, 15 minutes for this problem. If it's taking you longer to do a problem like this, that means you're not doing enough practice. Something like this should not take you more than 15 minutes to do. So for your test, which is coming up very shortly, right? In the beginning or at the end of the month. But I am thinking, because your class is somewhat behind than my other class, I am thinking of rescheduling your test. So it may not, I think right now it's at the end of the month. I forget the exact date. It's like September, I don't know. It's at the end of the month. But I think I may switch it and then postpone it to the following week. So it'll be early October. Okay, that's my plan for right now, postponing your test to give you enough time to get ready for the test. Okay? Yes.
In that problem, could you convert the 25 degrees to 65 degrees and instead of using sine, use cosine of 65 degrees?
Sure, you could have done that.
Okay.
So if you had 65 instead of using 25, what would change with my 120 pounds force here? It would not be sine of 25, but it would be?
Cosine of 65.
Sure, cosine of 65. And likewise for your R sub Y, 120 pounds, right? It won't be cosine 25, but it will be?
Sine of 65.
Sure. You could have done that.
Okay.
Okay. But why do I not suggest or recommend it to you? It's because I think all of us should be comfortable enough to see an angle and just work with it. And okay. Another thing is this, and this is probably more relevant to my students. When students take the difference. So you'll be 90 minus 25 to find the angle of inclination here, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it will be 65. But guess what I get from students? I get 75. So they actually end up making a mistake with a simple calculation. Instead of subtracting it from 90, in their heads they know, but for some reason they subtract it from 100. And that's why I prefer that we don't do any unnecessary calculation, but just work with the angle given. Okay, but yeah, Bobby, this would be perfectly fine. If this is what's more comfortable for you, that's fine. Okay, that's not wrong at all.
Okay.
This is wrong. 75 would be wrong.
And it's just easier for me to keep track of the x, y, like trying to remember that I would use sine for the fx, you know, because like cosine is your x value, sine is your y value. So that's why I did it. It was just, it was easier for me to keep track.
Sure. That's very good. That's fine. And I know I say this, until you get used to it, just do whatever makes sense for you, whatever is more comfortable for you, right? And then during this process of repeated process, you will then realize, oh, I could do it this way, because I'm comfortable enough that I can do it this way too, okay? So until you reach that point, I am fine with whatever works for you. But I still want to show you another way of looking at the same thing, because I think you guys should be exposed to different ways of doing the same thing. Because we're engineers, right? We should always have plans, alternative plans in case, right? Mm-hmm. Very good. Any other question on this? Okay. So
I just want to comment.
Sure. Jaehyun?
I seem to have made a typo in my answer. I put 150 pounds instead of 120, throwing all the calculations off.
That's another common mistake that I've been noticing. That's unfortunate. So yeah. What can we learn from this? Double check. Because I've noticed that many of you did not use 1 hour. I didn't expect you guys to. Because you guys cannot go back to previous problems, right? So when you're working on a problem like this, especially in a quiz, but on your test, I'll be collecting your papers, right? You guys will be uploading it or sending it to me, right? So I will be actually receiving your handwritten work, okay? But on a quiz like this, when you cannot go back to previous problems, so when you're on this problem, make sure to double check. And Jaehyun, you were not alone. I've had students using like 750 for something else. And I'm like, oh my God, why are we using this number? We have to double check.
Yep.
Okay, so just be cautious and use the time that you have. I gave you guys more than enough. I think I had a student who used like less than 25 minutes on this quiz. So I gave you more than enough so that you guys can take your time and check your work. Don't rush. I promise you, I'll give you enough time. Okay? I mean, you saw me doing this problem. And of course, I've done this many, many times. So it should not take me more than 5 minutes to do it, even with all the writing, right? But with you guys should be taking about 15 minutes for a problem like this. No, everything will be closed for the test. Yeah, my tests are never open. Even quiz, I mean, I never, even for the quizzes, honestly, I don't believe in open book, open notes. Because when it's open book, open notes, I've noticed students trying to learn while taking the test. So it doesn't really do them any good. So you should come prepared. But you're allowed to have a formula sheet. But there aren't too many formulas in this class. So if you don't know these formulas by now, then I will be very worried. But as a security blanket, if you want to have a blank sheet of paper with formulas written on it and just the formulas, that's fine, but you shouldn't really have anything else on it. But it's not open book, open notes. Everything is closed. Okay, anything else? See, these are the things that my online class students are not getting, unfortunately, because we don't have these questions coming in. So anyway, okay, then let me close this out, clear all the drawings so I can get rid of this. And then let me stop sharing this one. Oh, Jonathan, where's my note? What happened to my note? Okay, hold on. My notes disappeared. Why? I have them here. Okay. So let me go back and share. There it is. It disappeared from my screen. Okay, so I told you this last class, you have to hang on really tight because we're getting into the difficult zone. And I will try to make this as easy as possible. but you still have to hang on really, really tight. Okay, so let me go through what's coming ahead. So you guys can start working on homework 4 after today, and we're going to have another quiz before your test. I would feel so much better if I quiz you guys on 3D stuff before giving you a test. Because the test is more, I mean, it's worth more, right? So I want to make sure you guys can kind of got a handle on the 3D analysis before jumping into a test. And the test is scheduled to be due by September 24th. What's today? So 10 days from now, okay?